that if we are to get on the right side of the world revolution, we as a nation must undergo a radical revolution of values. We must rapidly begin the shift from a thing-oriented society to a person-oriented society. When machines and computers, profit motives and property rights are considered more important than people, the giant triplets of racism, extreme materialism, and militarism are incapable of being conquered. A true revolution of values will soon cause us to question the fairness and justice of many of our past and present policies. On the one hand, we are called to play the Good Samaritan on life's roadside, but that will be only an initial act. One day we must come to see that the whole Jericho Road must be transformed so that men and women will not be constantly beaten and robbed as they make their journey on life's highway. True compassion is more than flinging a coin to a beggar. It comes to see that an edifice which produces beggars needs restructuring.
Martin Luther King, Jr., of course. Now, Ernie Chapin is not Martin Luther King, Jr. He's late 60s. He looks like a goofy retired high school teacher and coach because that's what he is. But now he puts all his time into investing into kids in our area's juvenile justice system and helping empower teachers across the U.S. who work with at-risk kids. And as we were headed here, I ran into him at the airport, and he asked where we were flying, what we were doing. I told him about coming here, and he asked what it was that I was talking about. And I simply said, people first. And he just about jumped out of his chair with enthusiasm and shoved into my hand a workbook from his seminar, and on the cover was this quote. As a teacher, I possess tremendous power to make a child's life miserable or joyous. I can be a tool of torture or an instrument of inspiration. I can humiliate or humor, hurt or heal. In all situations, it is my response that decides whether a crisis will be escalated or de-escalated, and a child humanized or dehumanized. How many people think this just applies to teachers? Yeah, I didn't think so. It clearly doesn't. No matter your title, it is your job to make the people around you feel cared about, empowered, encouraged, and humanized. It doesn't matter what your job is. It doesn't matter if you consider yourself an engineer who's mainly focused on building things, or a designer that's mainly focused on making things useful and usable for people. No matter what, all of us work with people, and our number one job is to make people feel empowered, encouraged, and humanized, and cared about. And we all need to start with the people nearest. Just don't stop there. One of my favorite quotes, let everyone sweep in front of their own door and the whole world will be clean. This is where my doorstep starts for me. With Katie and Ephraim and Christy. So let me ask you a question. Why? Why do you do what you do? You, just like every person who came before you, want to leave your mark on the earth. You want to know that your life had meaning, that your time on earth wasn't wasted. And most certainly, we all want our life to have meaning now, and we want to make a meaningful difference. So why make software? Why build stuff for the web? And I think that for all of us here, we immediately recognize the answer to that question, which is technology massively multiplies our power, our influence, and reach. And as soon as we've had a taste of the potential impact that it can have, it's very hard to say, I'd rather do something that has nothing to do with it. Although many of us, I think, may have posed that question to ourselves. What lasts? We all know that the results of the software that we build do not endure. With the pace of change, probably 80% of the software that you're writing today is as good as worthless in 5 years. That's not a particularly exciting thing. That's a little sad to hear and think about. But the fact is that it does have an impact, because we don't do it alone. What will last are your individual interactions with people. No work that you do will have the kind of lasting impact that giving time and energy and care to individual people can have. Again, Martin Luther King Jr., life's most urgent and persistent question is, what are you doing for others? Now, let's be really honest, because we all have pain. Some of us have experienced tremendous loss, some even very recently. And others have been marked by pain for their entire lives. And there are some of us here who have regrets of hurting others that we hold on to every single day, and we know the hurt that we caused. And I personally know a few of the stories in this room, and there are some truly heartbreaking experiences that many who are here today have lived through. We all have pain. And our hurt will endlessly call out to us. And there's very little that we can do to silence those voices when we hear them. You will use your hurt. Some of the most amazing, most generous people I know have experienced a significant amount of hurt, and the question ultimately becomes, what will you use it for? You can use it to hurt yourself. You can use it to hurt others. Or we can use it to bring wisdom and healing and joy. We will all use our hurt. I was ranting because it's a topic that I tend to rant about just at length. I was ranting about unhealthy organizations and destructive approaches to managing humans, having observed some in a client situation, and was just incredibly frustrated with the way that some of the developers on our team were being treated by this particular client. And I basically popped off a few ranty tweets about the topic. And Michael Rogers immediately jumped in and said something. I don't remember exactly what he said, but it was something along the lines of, I think everybody should have to work in a horrible and oppressive work environment in their early 20s so they know what they never want to do to people. At first I kind of took that as, well, that sounds exactly like what Michael would say. And kind of actually just kind of brushed it off. But as I actually thought more about it, a light bulb went off for me, because so much of why the company that I love working with, our team at Anyet, so much of why it works the way that it does is because of the experience of having an incredibly challenging and hostile work environment that led me to feel completely depressed and suicidal for 2 years and nearly cost me everything I love in life. And none of the emphasis that we place on this being such an important thing in the way that we do our work, I don't think I ever would have addressed in such an emphatic way were it not for having that pain. How many people have heard of passion projects started by Julianne Horvath? Julie is at GitHub, and it's a monthly talk series that she started designed to help surface and celebrate work of incredible women that are in our industry. And some of you may have read her recent blog post. I found it to be just truly awesome. And listen to what she had to say in one particular segment. Every time I talk about what led me to create passion projects, I'm forced to revisit the negative experiences I've had in this industry. A coworker and friend recently pointed out that if I hadn't experienced these things, I might not be motivated to support other women in our community or create things that aim to improve the experiences for all women in this industry. Over the years, I've learned that the best way to make sure your experience doesn't go to waste is to invest it in the people around you. So if you see Julie on Twitter, tell her she's awesome and wise, and those are incredible words. My friend and colleague Philip Roberts has begun to write openly and with absolute vulnerability about his experience dealing with depression and getting counseling and medication and all of the details of that. Because it's been something that he's found to be so useful and something he's struggled with for so long and has recently gotten so much relief from. The fact is that every single one of us have unique sensitivities to the pain, the broad spectrum of pain that's possible in the human condition because of our experiences. And we can use that hurt to make things better for other people. So going back to the title, People First, it's really important to emphasize that it's not just people first, it's very, very strongly people first. The notion of people first is something that can't actually be tacked on to an organization. You can't paste on culture. A quality culture is something that emerges. It's the fruit of a tree that grows from putting people as a first order priority rather than having an infrastructure that has already gone well down the road and decides to do a few things that have the appearance of doing such things. If the roots of the tree are rotten, it doesn't matter how brightly we paint the leaves or how many apples we tape to the tree, it's not going to grow anything worth eating. So the notion of people first means that creating a culture of shipping is great, except that sometimes a culture of shipping means that shipping comes before before having a healthy balance in life. It means that building a meritocracy is a great thing, but suddenly does that mean that the person who goes through a very, very rough stretch in life, that they have less merit than those who have very little challenges in life. Clearly, I don't mean to simply dismiss those because I believe that those are both very positive, and I think they're things to aim at in cultures. But if those become the first things we pursue, they ultimately will be forced to make hard decisions at any given point. And the question comes: at what point do we make those choices and on what grounds and where those priorities ultimately lie? So let's talk about JSConf. I would argue that few pieces of software built in the last 6 years will have the enduring impact of JSConf. Let's go back to the question of what lasts that I asked early. The impact of JSConf will last not because of the power of technology and not because it's a system, but because it is deeply and resiliently human, and because the connections and the relationships that are found here that I have personally experienced incredible ripple effect of and made so many friends who I treasure so deeply, that those mean far more to me than any software ever could. And when I look out and see the great things that this community has done and the communities that have sprung up around the world, so many of those are far bigger and far greater than any software could ever be. And in fact, those relationships have empowered the software that we use. And so many of the great discussions that have occurred that have advanced the web over the last few years, I believe, have root in the culture and the connections and the community of JSConf and similarly inspired events and communities. Cargo culting culture won't work. Most people, I think, are familiar with the term cargo culting. Show of hands. Okay, so, I mean, generally, I won't go the whole length of explaining the term, but it means going through the motions without really knowing and understanding the reasons behind them. You could actually, in looking at the question of culture, you could cargo cult a conference. You could fill a really awesome venue with round tables and have awesome speakers and great entertainment and beer and amazing lighting and perfect sound and outstanding screens and great speakers and zero guarantee whatsoever that you would get the heart of what happens at an event like this one. I don't think that there's anyone that of those things that they would say yes, that's the entirety of what makes this valuable. If your aim was to duplicate the effect of JSConf, you would be unwise to start with the things that you can see. And that's part of the reason why I've heard Chris say before that when people are interested in running a JSConf and reach out to him and say, hey, we're starting a JSConf over here, and his first reaction is, okay, that's cool. Why don't you come to one before you go down that path? Because so often from the things that we see, we don't truly have the chance to understand the heart behind them. So instead, if we look at what the heart of the event is about and start from there and work outward, we may come to entirely different conclusions in terms of how to accomplish the same effects and the same feeling, even if the methods are different. And I think that one of the amazing principles of JSConf is actually Chris's self-limitation, that he has actually chosen to not make it into a global franchise, but instead has chosen to empower other people and to allow them to build things in their correct context, and for those people to lead in their communities. And I think that's outstanding. And I love this statement because I feel like it sums it up. So oftentimes we feel like we need to do big things, otherwise, why even try? But small things done with great love will change the world. Simple fact. So let's talk about small. A few months ago, I was in a conversation with some people who I respect who were talking about the obligation of talented software developers to do more ambitious things and to solve more difficult technical problems. And I'm not criticizing that point at all, but I want to focus the attention on a different direction. The thing is that many of the biggest and most important problems aren't in software and aren't going to be solved directly by software. They're in humans, in communities, in organizations, in societies. And developers have a tendency to want to solve the world with brilliantly conceived systems because that's what our community, that's what our industry attempts to do in our work. We like to solve problems and we like to find the most elegant possible system that solves the problem. But unfortunately, that's not the way most real positive change that lasts happens. In fact, masterminding a brilliant system for people has historically never ended that well. I put little faith in masterminded systems and hierarchies of great, great magnitude because I believe in the power of individual people. Someone give me some water, I'd love it. My mouth is totally dry. And ultimately, if the tiny decisions that we make don't value people, the big picture will drift that way as well. It'll just look a lot uglier. The world and our communities and organizations are built on massive and complex conglomeration of all of the tiny decisions that we make. So the answer is always to start as small as possible. The answer is not to build a system. Culture only scales organically. You have to put in the work of each individual interaction over and over. There are no shortcuts. There are no plans for scaling. There are no premature optimizations recommended. Always start as small as possible. And that means that it starts with you and me individually, as our own people. Again, one of my favorite quotes. Thank you so much. Yeah. Everyone thinks of changing the world, but nobody thinks of changing themselves. When we were at JSConf Brazil, their nation was in the midst of huge protests. I think most of you were somewhat aware of these in the news in June. And QMX, who was here last year and who organized JSConf Brazil, pointed out that while everyone hates the completely undeniable and completely rampant corruption that's in the government, the thing that he pointed out was that that the people have a culture of accepting and giving bribes and doing things like celebrating when they get back too much change instead of returning it. And he pointed out that most of the things, almost to a T, that people hate about the government are the same things that they choose to find acceptable on a smaller scale because they are a lesser evil and because they benefit and no harm done and all the rest. But how true it is that the small, tiny things that we do that don't seem like that big of a deal when taken on a greater scale add up to a significant difference. And this is regardless of culture or context, and it's easier to see standing outside of a culture than it is looking from within. When we don't like what we see in the world, we need to look inside too. Nearly every element of the things that we dislike about the state of the world, we can find in some atomic form in ourselves. When we see sexism or racism or egocentrism or abusive power or apathy or blind privilege demonstrated by others, it becomes our chance to evaluate ourselves and where we need to improve. When we look at businesses and organizations that operate in ways that we just can't stand, we have the chance to ask ourselves, in what areas have we compromised our own integrity? And how can we avoid the same fate? The truth is that we think of people who do the things that we strongly dislike about the world as if they are a different material from ourselves, because it's far easier to think that way, but they're ordinary people. The darkest plans in human history were made and carried out by people like us, and the best and most generous ideas were carried out and generated by people like us. One of the main reasons that it's so hard to create positive change is that most of the attempts to do it are aimed at solving the whole problem, with the goal being getting credit for it and profiting from it. My longtime mentor and friend Julian Genestu pointed out recently that people often have this tendency to want to reinvent the wheel simply so that we can put our own name on it. And you've probably heard this line before. It's amazing what you can get done when you don't care who gets credit. Most people, when confronted with the world's problems, think, I know, I'll solve this, and then I'll be rich and powerful. Now we have more problems. I mean, effectively, that is the entire problem. So one of the books that I've been mulling on for a bit is this book called The Gift, Creativity and the Artist in the Modern World. This author, Hyde, uses gifts, like gifts that you actually give, as an analogy for the individual talents that we have and the way that creativity is expressed in the world. And I certainly consider software development along the lines of creativity and artistry, as we've certainly seen throughout the last 2 days. And he one of the things that he does in the book is explains the underlying psychology and sociology of gift cultures in various ethnic groups and time periods, and uses these as an analogy and sort of a way to extract some meaning and understanding for us as creators of art of various forms in the modern world. I think that this is a terrifically relevant read for anyone who thinks about open source culture. How many people have heard the term Indian giver? So it is like it's a completely crazy racist term in the U.S. At least, and it means to give someone something and then kind of want to just like take it back. So people will say, "Oh man, he's an Indian giver because he gave me, you know, he gave me, I don't know, like I can't think of an example off the top of my head. I'm too tired. He gave me a sweater, and now he wants my sweater. Anyway, you get the idea." I don't know why I needed to find an example, but it was really important for you to understand. Anyway, so anyway, forget that nonsense. I'm going to drink some water. Anyway, the meaning of the term does a really good job of explaining the absolute cultural mismatch between Native Americans and Europeans. And I'm going to say Europeans because they were still kind of Europeans in the initial point of this, so... This is, I'm going to blame you guys, basically. Yeah, that's true. Actually, wait, no, shit. Dang it, that's a good point. Oh, man. Well, now my whole thing is ruined. All right, I'm going to rebuild my slides. Okay, so anyway, it's no secret that Native Americans, like many Aboriginal populations, lived completely sustainably. Like not in the like sustainable with a registered like trademark symbol after it, but like literally sustainably. They also didn't believe, as most people well know, they didn't believe in the notion of personal possessions in the slightest. So clearly, this contrasted with the European mindset of property as people were settling. And so the interesting thing is that gifts in Native culture were meant to be kept in motion. You didn't simply receive, you received and used for a while, or perhaps offered something that was of your own, of some value, back to the person as a gift. But it was the process of, I've had this for a while, I've gotten a reasonable amount of pretty good enjoyment out of it, and now I want to share that enjoyment, instead of like chuck it in the garage or something. So you can sort of imagine like how this came to be. So when the natives took back their pipes that they would give, they were trying to teach Europeans how to give. And it's amazing how they were completely insulted by their misunderstanding of something that was undeniably a far healthier and happier way of living. In the same Martin Luther King Jr. speech that I played earlier, he has another great quote later on where he says, "The Western arrogance of feeling that it has everything to teach others and nothing to learn from them is not just. If we really want to make the world a better place, we must keep in check our own selfish ambitions and we need to humbly consider others' ideas may well be better than our own. And consider that perhaps their unique vantage point may provide the keys to identifying what is broken about our own ways as far as we're concerned." And equally so, the developer arrogance of feeling that we have everything to teach the rest of the world and nothing to learn from it is not just. We have a strong tendency, and I myself fall pattern to this so often, of thinking that the web is made entirely of web developers, which is entirely nonsense. Let us never forget that the web is not for web developers. The web is for everyone. P- People first most especially means that I am not first. Many years ago, when Anyet was still just me, I read this line of a site on a web company that I respected a great deal, and it said, "Everyone who's ever become a part of our team has remained part of our team to this day. No one's ever quit." And you could feel like the joy and pride in those words. And then I remember sometime later, I visited the same site. This was just a local, larger design shop in our area. And I remember the day that I visited the same page and saw that line was gone. And its absence just sort of felt like this epitaph, like something happened there, because this line has now been edited, and it's just people like working here, sort of what it was replaced with. And in my naivety and arrogance, I felt like that meant that they'd failed. And I vowed that, you know, I would do better. And I would fight for, you know, making sure that, you know, people wanted to stay. And I truly fought it. And the naivety which led me to hope that everyone who was a part of our team would always be so deluded me into thinking that it was my job to maintain that fact and that doing otherwise was a failure on my part. And it was indeed wrong thinking. I'm convinced that people need the right situations to grow and pursue their passions. Sometimes you're the student, and sometimes the teacher, only to become the student again. Sometimes a company is the right fit for you to do the growing that you need to at the right place that you're at in life, and the pursuing of dreams that you can, and sometimes it just isn't any longer. And as much as in this particular situation, I would have loved to always have worked with every single incredibly talented person that I've ever had the chance of getting to, it would have been absolutely wrong and selfish for me to try to fight at the point that they had something that was calling them that was bigger or greater. And I love this quote so much. "People are not things to be manipulated, labeled, boxed, bought, and sold. Above all else, they are not human resources. We are entire human beings containing the whole of the evolving universe, limitless until we are limited, whether by self or by others." So let's unlimit people. People first is so much more than just don't be a dick. Encouragement is a huge... I'm a big encouragement geek, basically. Like, I discovered how powerful encouragement was in reflection on my own life and in reflection on various situations that I'd found myself in, and it started to blow my mind. I can point to many people here who have given me encouragement right when I needed it, and what a huge difference it's actually made for me to keep going. And I also have had the chance to see the impact of encouragement on other people that I've given, and seen them take on and go do entirely new things as a result of them simply expressing an idea and a passion, and me simply saying, "Yes, you totally should do that." And that being enough to them, to have them, "Yes, I believe in myself, I guess." Encouragement is really, really, really amazing. It's the only force that can change the world with words in the only way that matters, which is one person at a time. And they say energy can't be created or destroyed, but encouragement gives physics the finger. One thing that I've discovered is that people deeply desire permission. Permission to be themselves, permission to pursue their hearts, to grow, to be their best. But screw permission. Don't ask permission. Give it to yourself. And even better, give it to others. Manufacture it and distribute it. As Howard Thurman said, don't ask yourself what the world needs, ask yourself what makes you come alive, and then go do that, because what the world needs is people who have come alive. And I found the best way to start amazing conspiracies is simply to ask people to do exactly everything good their heart desires and do whatever you can to help that along. Because so many people that you know have great ideas and great things that they want to start, and they're just afraid. And all they need is one person to step up and tell them, "Yes, you can do that." So, practical. How do we put people first at our company? And yet, people often ask me, you know, how we work. I've had a couple of conversations over the last week on this. expressing this type of organization as being without managers does a bit of a disservice and actually misses the point. And I think if anybody saw the really amazing interview with Tom Presswarner of GitHub on Fox, like, he, you know, they say, oh, you just don't have managers. And he's like, well, no, really, it's about leadership. And I loved his answer. Completely agree with it. It's not enough to minimize management. You need to maximize leadership. In fact, the things that make us capable on our team of putting people first have everything to do with leadership. So just some basic principles. First, everyone, absolutely everyone, should be a leader of the team. In some capacity, there should be some way or some area where the rest of the team is following their lead. Second, and this is so important in understanding what leadership really means, which is leadership is about responsibility and care, not authority. For us, each new person that joins the team should fundamentally change it in some way. And this is essentially an integrity test of whether or not they've been empowered as a leader or effectively encouraged to do what it is that they can do best for the team. Ultimately, we believe that most problems are a problem of leadership, that things don't get solved by creating a system or a policy. They get solved because someone who cares and has the authority to make them better is leading. Accidental hierarchy is a monkey patch for missing leadership, and it should be replaced as quickly and reasonably as possible. There are times that it is just a necessity, but it's just kind of a kludge and a hack. People should bring their whole selves and their feelings to work. I really believe that the health and happiness of people's personal lives has a huge impact, I mean, this is clear, I think, to all of us, has a huge impact on our ability to do our best. And the opposite is true as well, that the quality of our work environment has a huge impact on our ability to be our best in our personal lives. And we want to accept the reality that people go through rough times and they need help and they need people that support and encourage them alongside. Next, conflict is an essential and healthy part of creativity. We can't avoid it. We have to embrace it. We have to run at it. And we have to build relationships that support making conflict happen in a useful and productive and positive way. Honesty is better than politeness, but always clean up your mess. If you need to say something, then say it. That's great. But know that you're likely going to need to say you're sorry and restore a relationship after working through a conflict. That's just the nature of conflict. People say things that they later learn that maybe they shouldn't have said, and we're always in the process of learning how to communicate better. As Gar on our team put it, never apologize for who you are or how you feel. Always, always apologize for what you do. Trust is everything, and trust is a choice, it's not a feeling. Trust is not negotiable. You either trust or you don't, and so you must constantly be in the process, we've discovered, of ensuring that there is trust among all of the people that you're working with. So, on the topic of people first, it was about 45 minutes after midnight at the end of a long and hard Monday, and I was lying in Christy's arms. And I knew how deeply that she loved me. And I already knew, of course. I mean, I knew it because for over 12 years, she's proven it time and again in significant ways, forgiving and believing the best and never failing. But more than that, I saw very clearly how none of the good in my life would ever have been without her, much more so than anyone else. And of course, I knew all that. But I'd never felt it ring in such a way. And after awaking in the dark, I I bolted from my bed and felt compelled to write down what I was thinking and feeling quite emphatically. A year and a half ago, we went through a really dark time in our company. In less than a week's time, we had a large amount of money stolen by a former employee. We had our largest client quit paying the bills. And we had every other project that we were working on suddenly run out of money and end. And that happened in the exact same time that my son was born. It just was like the worst possible timing for anything. And it actually got worse from there before it got better. But the one thing that I knew in the midst of it was that I'd personally seen darker and more difficult times, and there wasn't anything that could take away the things that we had that really mattered. 6 years ago in December was perhaps the most challenging and piercing moment of our lives as we almost lost everything. But we didn't. And it's because of Christy and because of how deeply she loves me. And as I realized that night something that I subconsciously already knew and already affirmed, but now felt resounding in my mind, in the years since, all the joys that we've seen together in our relationship, in the birth and growth of our family, in the inception and development of our company, in the skills and knowledge that I've been able to acquire, and the relationships and friendships that I've been able to make, that those were the results of seeds that she planted, tended, and refused to abandon. So my wife Christy is Anyet's only investor, and I expect that to remain. And I mean that in ways much more profound than the simple fact that she's the one who paid the vast majority of our family's bills the first few years of our company's existence. And yeah, on paper, I may hold the title through technicality, but I have to be clear about one thing, which is that I'm not the founder of Anyet, that Christy and her love for me is. And from the bottom of my heart and in the presence of everyone here, I thank her for it loudly. She loved me through the most painful 2 years of my life, and she loved me when I thought that I was truly worthless. One of my heroes, Jen, posted this a month ago. If you want to make the world a better place, you have to teach people they are valuable. When people value themselves, everything changes. There's no scalable way to do this, and there is no grand system that can be created. The only way that it happens is one person at a time. Thank you. Please.